to recognize something, usually you need to know what that something is. In the quest to understand the question of whether we are alone, this recognition problem looms large. Would we know an alien civilization if we saw it? The answer is that if that civilization were like us, using street lighting, sending out radio signals, and filling their atmosphere with industrial chemicals, then yes, we probably would recognize that. If that civilization had become a machine civilization and built a huge Dyson swarm emitting an infrared, yes, we probably would see that. But what of a nanotechnological civilization existing in space itself, as a cloud? The reality of that is that even though it would be the most advanced thing we've ever seen, we'd dismiss it as dust. But in attempting to envision what alien civilizations might be like on a broader scale, there have been a few systems of broad classification that try to begin the process of envisioning that which we have never seen and have no connection to yet, ultimately in hopes of finding out what we should be looking for. This is a confounding question because all we can really do right now is look at what we and our civilization does, then look for the same thing in space, such as the search for radio or laser signals from alien civilizations, because that's how we would see ourselves if we were in space looking back at Earth. But we're still primitive, just past the cusp of making detectable technology that can be seen at a distance. If you would have looked at Earth during the days of the Roman Empire, you would not have seen much that would indicate that there was a budding civilization here, that in under 2,000 years would set foot on the moon. But a civilization that lasts far longer, perhaps 10,000 or a million years of technological existence, well, what would that look like? We don't really know because we haven't had electricity that long. But one famous way to envision things is the Kardashev scale. First formulated in 1964 by Soviet astronomer Nikolai Kardashev and presented at a Soviet radio astronomy conference, the scale is based on fundamental, immutable physical laws that unless the aliens live outside of the physics of the universe, they would be just as beholden to as we are. Anything that lives outside of the physics of the universe is by definition no longer really part of it, and probably would be invisible, at least if it wanted to be. Why interact with electromagnetic radiation like light when you don't have to? In fairness, and Kardashev said this, there is still a human bias present in the scale. It is still based partly on what we do as a civilization. But past that, the scale is based on energy usage, and to a degree, exponential growth. The original version of the scale starts at type 1. This is a civilization that can access all the energy available on its planet and use and store it. With this comes the ability to control natural disasters, volcanoes, weather, earthquakes, and so on. Humanity cannot yet do that, thus we are type 0. We didn't even measure on the original scale. But since then, other thinkers have thought that type 0 clearly exists because we are one, with the general consensus that we sit somewhere around 0.7. A type 1 civilization is barely visible through things like radio emissions, atmospheric alterations, and basic technosignatures. Type 2 is a step up and can control the energy resources of an entire star, probably through a Dyson swarm. You could further divide this part of the scale into degrees as well, though Kardashev did not. You could have a civilization that locally controls, say, 100 stars, all with Dyson swarms collecting their energy. This type of civilization would be much more easily visible. You'd see a star, or a close grouping of stars, that are emitting very strangely in infrared, as their swarms absorbed light and emitted waste heat. This is due to thermodynamics, and cannot be gotten past in the universe. But dust does this too. It absorbs light and emits infrared. But you would also see a visual signature in the light curves of those stars giving an independent metric, telling you that something very unnatural is going on with that star. There was actually a dry run for this with Tabby's star. That star showed a bizarre light curve, less so these days, but it's still doing it to a degree, yet showed no infrared emission. That's actually stranger than what you'd expect, because it means that whatever was occluding that star was either very cold, or was somehow circumventing thermodynamics, leading to the hypothesis of cold disintegrating comets being responsible, which it may well be. But what would have changed the landscape of that bizarre star would have been if a visual measurement had shown the objects to be solid and large. This is just a matter of looking at what frequencies of visible light are being absorbed by the phenomenon. If you see differences between red and blue, then it's dust. And that profile actually tells you how large the dust grains are. That's what Tabby's star showed, though oddly, the dust was more like smoke. Very, very tiny grains. Which doesn't make a lot of sense for disintegrating or colliding objects. But had it blocked all frequencies outright, that would have taken it closer to technosignature territory. You'd expect a Dyson swarm or similar to be made of solid objects. But it would not have been a hole in one yet, because dust clouds can be optically thick as well. In short, to confirm it, there would have been further, more nuanced observations. Had that panned out, however, we would have been seeing a Kardashev Type 2 civilization. It must be said, though, we still do not know what exactly is going on with Tabby's star, because a number of mysteries remain that set this star apart from most other stars. Though other stars have since been identified clustering around Tabby's star that are doing similar things, it could still be a case of aliens doing something that we just don't recognize, or we can't gather enough data to figure it out. Type 3 on the Kardashev scale is a galaxy-spanning empire that controls the energy of every usable object in it, from all stars to black holes. If this type of civilization existed in a galaxy and used Dyson swarms, it would be visible as an unnaturally reddened galaxy, something that's been looked for but not seen. It's worth noting here that I'm not using the term Dyson sphere, because that implies a solid sphere. Those actually are possible to build, but somewhat unnecessary, and would need to be very thin, and the whole thing probably isn't practical. A swarm of individual energy collectors and structures, however, is eminently possible, thus Dyson swarm, and in fact our fleet of defunct spacecraft in solar orbit are a very rudimentary start of a Dyson swarm. We already have one. Though the aliens, if they know about it, probably laugh at it, if they laugh. There have been other additions to the Kardashev scale by others, including Type 4 that can use the power of a supercluster of galaxies, and a Type 5, which is basically a god that controls an entire universe. Kardashev went on to write more extensively about other aspects of alien civilizations that might aid in SETI, and many were implemented, and while we haven't seen any civilizations of any type, the search and the criteria used in the searches have identified a number of unusual astrophysical objects. Regardless of what you think of the Kardashev scale and whether aliens would choose to adhere to it is another matter, but at least it serves a purpose to have a starting point to begin to envision alien civilizations and thus what to look for. Many things in SETI are tools like that. The Drake equation is another one. It just provides a way to think about the subject, a starting point. But there are other metrics to go by, other than energy consumption. Indeed, Mars exploration champion Robert Zubrin suggested a variation based on harnessing resources. Instead of energy, the metric is how extensively you have developed the resources available to you. That of a planet, star system, and galaxy. And even Type 4 in this framework, which is a civilization that harnesses the entire resources of a universe. Another metric that has been advanced is based on the ability to control natural disasters. It has to be noted here that some of these upper order options suffer from another fundamental law of the universe, the speed of light. The bigger a civilization is, the longer the communications time. And if you get to the level of controlling a universe, say you head out at high relativistic speeds, and you end up on the other side of the observable universe, relativity lets you do that if you don't care about traveling to the future. But you won't be communicating with where you came from either, in space or time. At some point, the expansion of the universe prevents communication entirely, and you're so far into the future that you really can't be called the same civilization that you started as. You're something else. So there really can't be a unified civilization past a certain point. Another metric that has been proposed is the Barrow scale, and it is expressed as an anti-Kardashev scale in minuses. John D. Barrow proposed this, and it's based not on how big your civilization can go, but at what level it can manipulate its environment. So here, type 1 minus is a civilization that can build a Hilton out of brick and mortar. Type 2 minus can manipulate DNA and practice genetics. Type 3 minus can deal with molecules in general. Type 4 minus is harnessing individual atoms. Type 5 minus is being able to manipulate the atomic nucleus. Type 6 minus is a master of quarks and leptons. And finally, type omega minus, which is the ability to manipulate space and time itself on the smallest scales. The problem with that scale, however, is that it's difficult to define human civilization, because we can do some of those things, but not others. We don't really have a full mastery of every aspect of the entries on the scale, and it seems likely that aliens wouldn't either. Rather, everyone would be mixed bags for at least a large part of their existence. Yeah, we can build a Hilton, but we can't yet build a space elevator. Yet we can set off an atomic bomb and make all sorts of molecules, but there are still things that elude us. And it may never be possible for anyone in the universe to control space and time, at its fundamental level, or things below the atom, because everything at that kind of a scale gets so probabilistic and almost ghostly. Again, though, any of these scales are, in the end, thought experiments, and it may simply be that the reality of the universe is that no one ever chooses, or rarely chooses, to go big, and the limits on going small are blocked by the fundamental laws of the universe. Or civilizations are economical and stay at home, or become so nanotechnological that they use very little energy and become really efficient and don't need Dyson swarms or planets, or at some point feel their technological development is at its optimal level and never go any further. We may do this. The ultimate indicator for any of this is what we do as a civilization. And we stand at the precipice of a number of technologies that we may simply choose not to take to their fullest extent. These include automation, artificial intelligence, uploading your mind into a cloud, and many others that fundamentally alter our current world of the human. We may lose who we are if we develop these technologies further, and there have been instances, such as certain types of weapons of mass destruction, that we wrote treaties specifically in order to prevent anyone from pursuing them. Maybe those really are the situations that define alien civilizations, rather than broad, far-reaching systems like that of Kardashev and the others. Maybe it's always too situational. Food for thought. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently disturbed. I asked Anna what scale the possum civilization is, if he is indeed a possum. That has not been firmly established. And she said, none of them. There is such a thing as a multiverse. Very perplexing, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.